Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Robert Ayon, president of the Guayaquil Space Society, and we're very happy to be organizing this event for all of you together with our partners, Centro Ecuatoriano Norteamericano. And tonight we have a very special session for you where we really want to explore about how people's dreams in space and how space access can definitely lead some people to actually achieve it and follow the path of being an astronaut. And there are other folks, other persons on this planet who also want to follow those steps that other heroes have taken. So we really want to explore more about that and see how we can even get involved and what options are there for all of us. So right now, let's go ahead and start. And we really want to welcome everybody. And let me introduce Karina Galvez. Karina is going to be our moderator. Karina is a member of the Guayaquil Space Society, and she's also a poet, TV personality, radio personality, and a very important member of our group who has been doing an excellent work in moderating all of the events. So, Karina, welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. And we have, as Robert said, a very, very special night because we are all going to learn what we need to do if we want to go to space or what people who have already gone have done to actually make it there. This is brought to you by the Guayaquil Space Society. The Guayaquil Space Society was founded on November the 6th, 2019. And we are the only space society in Latin America so far, but hopefully some other countries start joining in. We are part of the National Space Society. And now I would like to bring to the screen to our wonderful Consuelo Hidalgo. She's part of CEN. CEN stands for Centro Ecuatoriano Norteamericano. They've been teaching English in Ecuador for decades. And we are honored to be sponsored by the CEN. Right now, Robert and I, and also Rick, whom you'll be seeing in a few minutes, are actually at the Guayaquil Oro Verde Hotel. It's a major hotel in Guayaquil, and they've been very, very kind to receive us ever since the creation of our space society. So from Guayaquil to the world, welcome so much. Thank you so much for being here. Now we have Consuelo Hidalgo with us. Consuelo,
you can unmute your... There. Hello, I'm sorry. Hello to everyone and welcome. The CEN, as I said, the Ecuador United States Binational Center is part of the American spaces that the U.S. State Department has around the world. And we have always been very enthusiastic with the Guayaquil Space Society, especially with Robert's projects. In 2019, he brought Dr. Baker, astronaut here to Guayaquil, and we had the chance to talk with her and develop future STEM programs for girls as a girl empowerment. And this program will be led as soon as we can with Robert. So thank you. And we will always be part and supporting this kind of activities. And welcome to everyone to this fabulous panel that we have today.
Thank you so much, Consuelo. In 1824, a treaty was signed. It was called the Treaty of Peace, Friendship, Navigation, and Commerce. And from there, Mr. William Wheelwright was the first consul general in Guayaquil. This is 1824, 6 years even before the country of Ecuador was created. So Guayaquil has always had a very close connection with the United States of America, and it is my honor to bring to you Rick Matton. He is a general services officer with the U.S. consulate in Guayaquil. He is a 27-year veteran from the United States Air Force, and we are very honored to have him here. So I'm going to put myself on mute because Rick is really close to me, and if I don't put myself on mute, then we get an echo. So just 3 seconds for technical issues.
Thank you, Karina, for your warm introduction. It's a tremendous honor to be here with you again tonight, representing the United States Diplomatic Mission to Ecuador. It was actually 4 months ago to the day when I was able to spend some time with this remarkable group when you guys celebrated your first anniversary. And that was a very special event, and I was so impressed by the enthusiasm that all of you, as well as the guest speakers, shared about this very important topic of our generation, space. And tonight, I have the privilege of being with you again, and the agenda seems equally as compelling. Your guest speaker has had an incredible career in space, and much like you, I can't wait to hear his story on how you became an astronaut. I want to thank Mr. Robert Ayon, CEO of Leviathan Space Industries, for the invitation to speak to you tonight, as well as all those involved in the organization of the gathering of this Guayaquil Space Society. Thank you. It's an exciting time for space. As an American diplomat, I'm so proud to see my country rejuvenating its leadership role in the final frontier. And just as importantly, the United States understands that it needs capable partners to join in the pursuit of possibilities in space. And through organizations like yours, Ecuador is clearly showing the world its potential and desire to explore above and beyond the limits of our stratosphere. And you only have to take a look at this week's news alone to get an idea of the extent to which America and the world is rejuvenating its interest in space. The commercial sector in particular has put some heavy investment into space recently. Once again, Elon Musk's private space flight company made the news. SpaceX launched its Falcon 9 rocket last week that deployed a payload of 60 satellites only an hour after liftoff. And these satellites will link up with other satellites in the company's growing constellation, which will reportedly be able to give online access to people in remote areas of the world. And I find that to be a great venture. But that's not all that happened this week in space. Just a few days ago, NASA's Mars rover Perseverance sent back to Earth its first recordings of lasers tapping Martian rocks. Apparently, scientists can study changes in the sound of these lasers hitting the rocks to help discover any signs of life that may have existed on Mars. And that's truly amazing. And this mission caught the attention of the United States President Biden, who remarked that the mission of the Perseverance is so much bigger than just landing on Mars. Indeed, he praised the mission as bringing back the American spirit to space in a time where we so desperately needed that. And I can see that same spirit here in Guayaquil Space Society is definitely contagious. Finally, and what I thought to be the most exciting news from this past week was the report that scientists spotted a planet orbiting a star considered to be relatively close to our solar system. It's classified as a super Earth, and it's been labeled Gliese 486b. It's said that studying this Earth-like planet could provide more clues to finding extraterrestrial life, with help, of course, from some very powerful telescopes. Now, I know I said finally, but there was one more piece of interesting space news from last week. Astronauts at the International Space Station conducted their fifth spacewalk of 2021 and the 237th spacewalk overall in support of the space station. And the astronauts addressed the timing of the spacewalk, which occurred about a year after so many of us went into quarantine. In a brief video message, they said, "We're there for each other. From 250 miles up, I see us united as a people. Crew One named our Dragon capsule Resilience, in part to honor all of you and the amazing tenacity that you've shown over the past year while overcoming obstacle after obstacle. Keep it up and take care of each other. It's been one tough year, but together we can make sure there's a brighter year ahead." And I thought that was a really hopeful message for all of us. So that's space news from just this past week. It's obvious to me that the world has embraced space exploration for the foreseeable future. And speaking of the future, let's move on from the past and hear from our guest speaker on how to pursue your future in space. There's so much cool stuff that's been accomplished in the history of space travel and exploration. And today, the possibilities continue to be endless, but are much more readily available. I'm excited to see you all as space enthusiasts reaching for the stars and fulfillment of your dreams. And I want to conclude by again congratulating you on another great event. I thank you for letting me be a part of it. And I very much look forward to spending the rest of the evening with all of you. I wish you the best in achieving your personal dreams while furthering the mission objectives of the Guayaquil Space Society and beyond. On behalf of the U.S. mission in Ecuador, good luck and Godspeed. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rick, Matten, for those words. We can certainly learn so much about all of our guests and about what surrounds us. And if we think about space and how big it is, and we can't, sometimes we can say, well, maybe there is no life someplace in space. Well, there is life in space. We happen to be floating in space. So here we are. The Guayaquil Space Society is very focused on getting people enthusiastic about learning, anything that has to do with STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. And in order to be enthusiastic to learn, you have to really start from a young age. So Robert, with his wild, wild, wild ideas, a year and a half ago, came up with this idea of talking to children from the Javier School, and they came up with this wild idea of sending seeds from Ecuador to space. And the world and space works on whom you know. And Robert Ayon happened to know the right person, and the right person happens to be here, and he's allowing us to make a lot of wild dreams come true. One of those dreams was to send, and we actually did, send radish seeds to the space. And those seeds were supposed to come back like around February 2020. They left on November the 2nd, 2019. And then something happened in space. Well, you know, things can happen in space. And they said, well, they're going to arrive next month. Well, guess what? The following month happened to be March 2020. And that's when the pandemic started. So the seeds just floated and floated in the air. And they finally made it back to land on the 12th of January. And they made it back to Ecuador just last week. Along with that dream, there's also a dream of children talking to the astronauts. And that's when this person also helped us fulfill that dream. So it is my honor to introduce to you Mr. David Alexander. He's going to talk to us about this wonderful, wonderful, crazy idea made true about children talking to astronauts. David Alexander.
Wow, I was expecting to jump in for a 2-minute intro, and that was quite amazing. I cannot take any credit for the seeds. That's all Robert and his work. And so, I'm really sad that I'm interrupting the flow, because the two speakers tonight are absolute stars, and I'm going to have to leave. So I'm going to have to miss. I'm going to have to watch the recording. And I don't want to keep you away from these two wonderful speakers with this wonderful topic. But it is a testament, the kinds of people that Robert can bring to this forum, the kind of work he's doing. And so you're in for a treat tonight. So I will try and be very brief, and so that you can get to the main event. What Karina was talking about is, in Houston, we have many friends who happen to be astronauts, and we have a couple up on the space station right now. And one of them, Dr. Kate Rubens, came to me just a little bit over a year ago and asked if I would be interested in doing having her live crew event. The astronauts are allowed to pick a live event, and whether she would like to do that with the Rice Space Institute. I'm the director of the Space Institute at Rice University in Houston. And so that gave me an idea of something I'd been working on for a while, and knowing people like Robert and various other people, what we decided to do was to make a multinational, multicultural event. So what we're doing, just to cut to the chase, on April 8th, we start our programming at 8 a.m. Guayaquil time, and it'll run till 10 a.m. It's being run out of Scotland. But in the middle of that, our highlight is that we will have a live downlink featuring Dr. Kate Rubens, who's currently on the space station as part of Expedition 64, and Colonel Mike Hopkins, who's also on the space station as part of SpaceX Crew One. And so we will have the opportunity for our students, students from Guayaquil, students from Scotland, which is my home country, and students from Houston, will all have the opportunity to ask the questions of the astronauts live from the space station. So we're at the moment we're circulating the information. We have a platform that we're using, and hopefully you'll all be able to join us for that event. We have over 45 questions. We will only be able to address about 16 or 17. I think Greg speaks quickly, so he probably gets through about 24 of them, but we'll probably only get through about 16 or 17 of them. But we've got all of the Guayaquil ones will be addressed on station, and all of the additional questions will be addressed after the event, immediately after the event, with another astronaut called Serena Onan-Chancellor, who's another wonderful person. So we're really excited about it. We've got some interesting moments in the pre-show, including a poem from Guayaquil, some people that you know of from Ecuador, famous people from Ecuador, so let me just say that. And we have a few VIPs from Scotland and Houston. So really, really looking forward to it. Appreciate the help of Robert and the Guayaquil Space Society and everyone else who's involved. So I'm really, really excited. It took NASA a while to give us a date, but we now have it and we're hoping they'll stick to it. But my fingers are crossed, my feet are crossed, and everything else is crossed. So thank you for the opportunity to mention this, Robert and Karina. It's a great partnership we have, and I think we'll do great things together, but it's that next generation that's important, and I think anything we can do to make their path clearer, I think, would be really good. So again, I apologize for interrupting the main proceedings. I appreciate the patience of Greg and Sammy, and again, the floor is all yours. This is going to be an interesting treat. I'll hang on for 2 minutes and I'll say goodbye, but I apologize for that. So thank you.
Thank you so very much, David, Alexander. And just to give you an idea of who the VIPs might be, we're going to have Nicola Sturgeon. She's the Prime Minister of Scotland. Sylvester Turner, Houston, the Mayor of Houston. Rosalie Arteaga, former President of Ecuador, and our current Ambassador to the U.S. She's based in Washington, Mrs. Yvonne Backey. And so, yeah, we're all excited. And so hopefully you can join us on the 8th of April. And space, I guess anybody who thinks about space thinks about playing and games. And I want to be an astronaut and I need to play with that. So LEGO decided to come up with the new space shuttle. So if you're ready to play with that, and LEGO is not a sponsor, we're just enthusiastic about LEGO-ness. Well, and now we're going to say hello to Greg Johnson. Please make sure that you learn this. Gregory H. Learn that H. It's important. And also Box, E-O-X. Keep that in mind because it will come up later on. But just to give you an idea of who Greg is. He's a wonderful man. And he's a NASA astronaut and retired colonel from the United States Air Force. He's a veteran of two space flights, the STS-123 and the STS-134. He served as pilot on his first mission, which delivered the Kibo logistics module and the Dexter robot arm to the International Space Station. His life is really, really interesting, but just to give you a little bit of idea, he also, in 2001, he was reassigned from FCOD, which stands for Flight Crew Operations Directorate, to the Space Shuttle branch where he has held various positions. In 2004, he was designated as deputy chief of the astronaut safety branch, focusing on all aspects of space shuttle, International Space Station, and T-38 safety, with special emphasis on improving specific operational procedures and techniques to make astronauts safer. He retired from the Air Force in 2009 and continued to serve in NASA as a civilian. We welcome Greg Johnson.
Thank you all. It's wonderful to be here. I see there are over 65 people from all over the world. I guess, Sammy, you're probably the most remote time zone, but I was checking the list. There's several people from Houston. So hello, I'm in Houston as well, and happy to join you this wonderful evening. I'd also like to thank other people who were contributing to this effort. Space Nation is one. It's a company that I've been supporting, advising them to help people around the planet become universal citizens. I mean, we are all in this together. This global pandemic illustrates that we're globally interconnected. We need to take care of each other. We need to take care of our planet. And Space Nation is trying to educate people about space and offer pathways that maybe Sammy could even use to help you pursue your dreams. And finally, I'd like to make a call out to a very special young lady who, an 8-year-old who hopefully is in the audience. I think she was gonna join us. But Noelle Colombo is about the same age that I was when I first got the dream to become an astronaut. And I hope she's inspired by this presentation. I hope she has fun, and I hope she gets better. So I'm really happy to be here. I'm gonna start off with a video that'll kind of put everybody in the mood. It's about a 3-minute video from this shuttle flight, STS-134, and then I'll flip through some photos really quickly. I'm not gonna tell you how to be an astronaut, but I will share with you how I was lucky enough to become an astronaut, and then we could talk about ideas, how those future much smarter than I am astronauts will be selected in the future. So with that, I'm going to share my screen. And I'm sharing sound. That's good. All right. Are you guys seeing it now? I'm not hearing anybody say no. So here we go.
Ride. I couldn't see anything but the lockers, but it was still a lot of fun.
No master alarms.
I'll have to say it was a lot different than flying on the Soyuz.
All right.
You guys look great. Well, you know why I'm wearing these? Because it looks cool.
It looks cool.
Hey, I've got a pair of those.
Yeah.
Some Fiesta chicken. That's the best stuff.
Never been in space before.
Houston on the big loop, we're Cali Ho with the station. Initiating RPM on my mark. 3, 2, 1, mark.
Houston,
10 and station. Capture is confirmed.
Never arriving.
Demon! Welcome on the station.
So that video is near and dear to my heart. It's just a teaser from our 12-minute crew video that shows the flight from soup to nuts in space. It was just about exactly 10 years ago, that last space shuttle flight, when we were just completing the assembly of the International Space Station that's in the center of this this slide. You know, we've got an amazing world, and we're expanding our frontiers every day, every week, every year. And as Rick told us, the wonderful milestones that have happened recently in space, we see Mars as a future horizon that hopefully Sammy will get to visit someday. It started for me when I was 7 years old, watching a black and white TV at my grandparents' house. As I said, I was just a year younger than Noelle when I got the dream to become an astronaut. And it took an awfully long time to become an astronaut. I didn't get to the core until I was almost 40. That kind of dates me, since that was about 20 years ago. I started off as an Air Force pilot, fighter pilot, test pilot, and then that was my path into the astronaut corps. But I'd like to point out that there are different touch points throughout our lives, from parents, friends, from co-workers. In my case, Charlie Bolden in the center of the screen was one of those links, one of those motivators for me when I was in the Air Force, when he had just flown as a pilot astronaut just a couple times. He had just come back from Hubble Space Telescope back in the early 90s. And that was the last, you know, he said, why not? Why not try and pursue your dream? So I really didn't think I'd become an astronaut, had a chance to become an astronaut, until after that conversation with Charlie, where he said, you know, maybe you should throw your hat in the ring. So sure enough, in 1998, I joined the class, the group 17. Ellen Baker, Dr. Ellen Baker, who talked to you all recently, I heard, she was part of my astronaut selection committee, along with several others. And I just wanted to get the interview. I didn't really think I'd get picked. You might notice our class is not very diverse. Back 20 years ago, even, we didn't have the equality across the spectrum that we do now. Now the astronaut classes, you'll find they're 50-50 men and women, and all the cultures are represented from all walks of life. This was my first space flight, as Katrina said. STS-123 was about, Karina, I'm sorry, it was about 13 years ago. And I was happier than a clam. You had to pinch me before we actually got to, I got to fly in space the first time. We went up to the International Space Station. It was a night launch. We took several things up, as Karina said. We did spacewalks. I never got to do one, but I helped. Five spacewalks on this flight and four others as we completed our 16-day mission. The space station is an amazing laboratory, and I'll share a little bit about the space station at the end of this presentation. But that's what the space station looked like in 2008, when STS-123 departed. And you might notice that part of the space station is not, the other solar array has not been installed yet. And so we were in the process of that 12-year period of building the International Space Station. My second flight was STS-134. This is our Star Trek copycat pose. And we were a day launch. It was still just as crazy, zipping up, going a couple times the speed of sound right there, a few seconds after liftoff, and approaching the International Space Station, this time with a whole new set of payloads. It was the final flight of Endeavour, And we took up the alpha magnetic spectrometer, which is a really important experiment that's been up there for almost a decade now. And it's helping us understand the origin of our universe. There's the AMS close up. It's a 15-nation collaboration. And we're using robotic arms to move things around in space, hand off between the shuttle and the space station, and attach the AMS to the top of the truss. Another spacewalk. I really call them space crawls because they really don't walk out there. Your feet do not have the same purpose in microgravity that they do here on Earth. Gives you a sense of scale of how big the space station is. It's about the size of a sports arena. I love this photo because it reminds me of Neil Armstrong on that first flight when he and Buzz Aldrin took a photo very similar to this one. And that's what the space station looked like almost a decade ago when we left on Endeavour's final flight. This is a photo of our planet Earth, and you can see some Russian Soyuz modules in the foreground there. But the northern lights are spectacular. This photo is not enhanced in any way. Unbelievable, this beautiful planet that we live on. Working and living in space, what, just a day-to-day picture there. Sleeping in space, it's like a camp out, really. The beautiful coastlines of outer space. I passed over South America during the daytime, probably more than any other continent on my second flight. This is in South America, by the way, but I would just like to point out how beautiful that continent is and how I long to visit Ecuador someday. I actually was planning to join Robert last year, but COVID kind of got in the way. The weather patterns, amazing. This is a hurricane wannabe. The Himalayas, this is Mount Everest from space, about 250 nautical miles just outside the atmosphere. Our planet is beautiful. You can see the fragile atmosphere. Every breath that we breathe here on spaceship Earth is comes from that thin film of atmosphere that we must take care of to help ourselves and our global community. The first rock band in space, I believe. We had a three-piece band, and I'm in my music room here in Houston. I come from a family of musicians, and so it's been transformed into a studio during this pandemic, but I remember how much fun we had up in space. The International Space Station, truly an amazing international collaboration, probably the greatest engineering feat of our civilization. So I'll close by talking a little bit about the International Space Station. I want to be a little bit brief here. The space station weighs about 1 million pounds. It took a dozen years to put the space station together, about 35 or 40 shuttle flights, depending on how you count them. And now we're going to be highlighting some of the different modules. There's three laboratories on the space station, the European lab you see. We also have the US lab and then the Japanese lab. And that's just on the front half of the space station. The Russians also have laboratories on the back half of the space station. The truss that goes across the entire span of the space station, you have to be on a spacewalk to go out in the truss. But all these modules that are interconnected are all pressurized so you can float between the different modules. And you saw us at the end of the video coming in the very front of the space station, entering into that node on which we had six astronauts living and working on the space station for months as we arrived. It's just amazing the amount of effort and the contributions to our society that this space station offers. It travels around the Earth every 90 minutes. It's going about 17,500 miles an hour, about 28,000 kilometers per hour. And we do science, we do technology development, and we do some STEM up there, which is probably why David was able to help get a STEM payload flown in space for you all. So I'll stop there. We'll have a lot of time to talk about the space shuttle, the space stations, but I wanted you to get just a sense for how wonderful and how lucky I am to have been able to have part of my career as an astronaut. So with that, I will stop sharing and you can, Karina, you can continue on. I hope that was fun.
It was so fun, Greg. I'm sure we all have a lot of questions. Usually at the Guayaquil Space Society, we also ask the speakers to ask each other some questions. So I'm sure Sammy will have a lot of questions for you too. So now I'm going to introduce to you Samantha. She goes by Sammy. Sammy Rains. She's from Australia, and she is an artificial intelligence engineer. She's a developer of all things, tech enthusiast, and avid space fan. She's passionate about technology and loves to combine creativity with imagination to bring ideas to life using hardware and software solutions. She's usually found coding away, building games, putting things apart, putting them back together. And now we are so honored to have her here. And she is also on her path to go to space. Thank you so much, Sammy Rains. She's a career astronaut candidate. Thank you so much, Sam.
Thank you. And thanks everyone for having me here today. I'm super excited. And Greg, holy moly, that was amazing. Definitely inspired me some more. So I'm in Brisbane, Australia. So I'm actually, you know, hello from the future. I'm ahead of the time. So it's, you know, 10 in the morning for me. So I just wanted to take you through, obviously, my journey, what I call my space journey, especially from, you know, my point of view, being an aspiring astronaut. So I will share that with you and talk you through it. So for me, growing up in Queensland, in Australia, we're pretty lucky that we don't have a lot of light pollution. So fortunate enough to grow up on, you know, property and just see stars at night. So for me, the two most, contributing factors to inspiring me were actually watching the stars at night and seeing those from my backyard, sitting outside with my family, looking through the telescope, that sort of thing. But I guess also as to how I got where I am, and I promise this will tie into it, is playing video games, which I know sounds like a bit of a strange one. So for me, one of my first gaming consoles was a Nintendo 64. And I remember playing Banjo-Kazooie. I'm not sure if people are going to remember this one, but I just remember watching it and I was pressing some of the buttons and I was like, well, hang on a minute. Like, when I press these, how does that character know how to flip? Or like, how does it know how to, you know, pick its little backpack up and go for a run sort of thing? So for me, I think that was a bit of a defining moment because it got me more curious into how things work and how things do go together. So with that, it obviously started my career in working towards computer science. So as you know, going through the years, I was always Lego, putting things together, like early days robotics bits and pieces. But then I started working, and one of the things I did was create an environmental safety box for underground mining, so using Raspberry Pis. So in Australia, we do have a lot of mines, and there's obviously a lot of toxic, or you know, there's natural gases, and you have to keep an eye on those, especially with everyone being underground. So one of the ones there was I helped build this environmental safety box, which had the ability to send alerts and notifications over a peer-to-peer mesh network. So it was a pretty tough one, but it was awesome to achieve because especially being underground, communications is not something that comes naturally underground. From there, it sort of kickstarted, I guess, even more my love for IoT and the hardware side of things. So from that, I actually got an email to say that NASA was doing one of their space apps challenges in Melbourne. So I was in Melbourne at the time, and a few of us just got together and we're just like, you know what, like, let's just try and build something. So we ended up just getting all these parts and just plumbing bits and pieces to build a jetpack rocket engine. And so we designed that one for Mars, and we ended up winning best hardware, which was even better. And I've still got, you know, that small little trophy somewhere reminding me that every sort of step, or, you know, there's always something you can do to keep working towards your goals. Off the back of that one, I got invited to mentor and help with the Melbourne Space Program. So they launched a satellite a couple of years ago, which was incredible. There hasn't been too many satellites launched from Australia. So it's, you know, getting the next generation as well through and helping those at universities to understand that there are ways we can contribute to space, and there's definitely things we can be working on. So I'm still helping them out. I still am a computer science mentor for them. So helping if they've got any challenges from, you know, anything on the algorithm side or understanding how to put the hardware and bits and pieces together. It was all these sorts of things that actually led me to, someone sent me an application to apply to be a career astronaut candidate. And I was just like, oh my God, like this is the thing. So for me, I was just like, oh, I have to try. Put everything together, and I went through a couple of stages, and then it was last year that I heard, you know, just out of the blue that I was successful. So I'm one of 18 people globally to form a career astronaut group. So we've got bits and pieces we're going to be doing over the next 5 years. Not that I have too many details on it at the moment, but fortunate enough to say that, you know, it is a stepping stone. I can say I'm a career astronaut candidate, which again, for me is incredible. more recently, however, I attended the International Space University. So they're a dedicated university to just space activities. So I attended their Southern Hemisphere Space Studies program. So that one was a 5-week course, and I'll talk through that a bit more in the next slide, but it was all things space, and that's how I've met Robert and a ton of other great people. Then just here as well, and for me, this does fit in with everything I do, is I'm also a diving instructor. So I teach things from like people from open water. I do a lot of rescue and emergency first responder. I'm also an instructor in teaching people with disabilities how to dive. So that's anyone, if they might have, you know, PTSD or something like that, is showing them how to cope underwater, but also showing their dive buddy. So making sure that people feel comfortable in that environment. I do a lot of conservation and reef cleanups as well. Very much believe that we should look after our planet, and so love helping with that side of things. And then I do a lot of deep and shipwreck diving too. There's obviously a lot of shipwrecks around Australia, so it's good fun to go dive those when I get a chance. So talking about space university, so this one here is just a few of the subjects actually that we went through. So I was blown away by how much we learned and how incredible this was. So I wanted to include it. I think just from the get-go, meeting the fellow participants and everything like that, there was 33 of us from around the world. It was online, obviously, due to COVID, but we managed to all gel together and learned tons. So a few of the highlights there was, you know, being in the same room, and it's similar to this, is, you know, I got to meet like John Connolly, who's the director of the Human Landing Systems Program at NASA. I got to chat to James Green, who is NASA's chief scientist. So I got to chat to him about all things solar flares. So that's definitely one thing I think I got known for, is I am so interested in solar flares and like their impact to Earth. And so it was great to chat to Dr. James Green about that one. It was great to also, we had an international astronaut panel. So I was fortunate enough to chat to others as well. And then got to chat to Mike Fink, who is an astronaut with NASA too. So that was good fun. As well as that, so our main project for Space University was on the topic of space and bushfires. Being Australian, this obviously is pretty close to home for me. So we looked at how space assets and technologies can be better applied to predict and mitigate bushfires and their impacts. So this one here is, this was just more so our exec summary. So we put together a report on what we would recommend going forward to help mitigate and predict bushfires better. So a lot of this was implementing like a national approach that, you know, can be taken globally, because it is a global, I guess, concern, and it does impact globally. Then we went through, and there was, you know, recommendations around lightning specific sensors, as well as adapting our fire fighters equipment and specifically their suits. One of the ideas that came up was, well, you know, they're on the front line. Why can't we liken it to astronaut suits and, you know, have a better suit for them to be able to survive and face the fires with those as well? So I'm not sure if anyone can sense a theme here, but for me, what drives me to be an astronaut is I want to continue to look after Earth while aiming for the stars. So especially with my technology and computer science background, I firmly believe that technology can impact in positive ways. And it's something that I'm definitely working towards and working more on. So similar to the team project, so bushfire prevention, there's a lot of things around conservation and how technology, especially artificial intelligence, can help in that aspect. And I definitely believe that space can help with life on Earth. So things from food systems engineering, Earth observation, anything like that. I definitely think that what we do when we look for space exploration, we should always tie back to Earth and help those here as well. So for me, what's next on my journey? I will have the career astronaut training. Unfortunately, I don't have too many details on it at the moment, just with COVID. We're just waiting to see what happens there. But I've also been fortunate enough to be accepted to go on a deep sea exploration mission to the Titanic, which is super exciting. So I'm going to be doing that one next year. So I'm very much a sea and space person. That's me for sure. So that one would be good. And especially, you know, I can help with dive planning, but it's more so for scientific research. So using artificial intelligence and some of the computer vision aspects to help map and yeah, just have a look really. Then this one here, this is one of my favorite quotes and I just wanted to include it because it's something that resonates with me. So I always say, you know, like look up, there's always something in the sky that you can see and there's something around that, you know, can inspire you. So this quote from Stephen Hawking around looking up and to just see the world with eyes of wonder, essentially, and be curious. And that, again, no matter what you do, I think everything you do can work towards your goals. Just one step at a time, you'll find after a while that you look back and you realize actually it has all contributed. And that's similar to what my space journey is about for me. I can see how everything I've done over the years has actually worked towards it and combined, which is fantastic. So with that, Ad Astra, thank you. I will stop sharing now and then back to you, Karina.
Thank you so much, Tammy, and that was fascinating. It's really, really, really interesting. Thank you so much. Thank you much to both our speakers. And now we're going to have some questions from this area here, questions from the chat and questions to from each speaker to the other speaker.
Karina, this is Greg. Can I, before we have questions, can I make a statement?
Absolutely.
A couple statements, if that's okay. Sammy, you are so well on your way to becoming an astronaut. I'll tell you, you're much more focused and driven on that one goal than I was. Although I will tell you, it was my dream since I was very, very young, but I didn't believe in myself maybe as much as you did. And I wanna read a couple adjectives that I wrote down for astronauts. And this is before you talked. Team player, dedicated, hardworking, and driven, just like you. Curious, just like Stephen Hawking mentioned. You have to have some skills. You definitely have some skills. Focus, humble, being social, being confident, and then doing what you love and do it well. I just wanted it because each one of those things you've already done. And I'm not going to predict that you're going to be able to fly in space, but I hope you do. And I'd trade places with you in a heartbeat. You can have two flights in your back pocket, and then I'll take all the things that are gonna happen in the future in trade. So I'll just tell you, I loved hearing about your inspiration and your excitement about space, and I'm just happy to be here. So I'll shut up now.
Ah, thank you so much. That's so great to hear. Thanks for that.
Thank you so much. And since there are no coincidences in life or in space or in Earth, I am sure when somebody's going to do a check mark or who should go, I am already predicting maybe, just maybe, Greg Johnson will be the one who says, yeah, I know Sammy. He was a guest speaker at the Guayaquil Space Society when I was there. I choose her to go. Wouldn't that be wonderful? That would be absolutely beautiful. Sammy, one question. How would you feel seeing that the whole Earth is now your down under?
How would I see it, as in from space?
Oh, yeah. You come from the land down under.
Oh, yeah.
Well, but if you go all the way up to space, then we all become the land down under.
Oh, I think that's fitting for me. It's certainly one of those things, though. I might be, you know, upside down here, down under, but for me, it always feels a bit on top. So, but I think as well, seeing it from that aspect, not only see then Australia, but I think Earth as a whole. And for me, I think that's the important aspect, because I see it is one. It'd be amazing to see that, and just, you know, we're in this together, essentially.
Yeah, absolutely. We're all in this together. Now, Valeria Moran would like to ask you whether you actually create robots. I'll try to find her question here. Sammy, do you create robots to send them to Mars or other places in the space?
So the robotics I do is more so just small scale. So it's things like robotic self-driving cars. So from my point of view, it's understanding the artificial intelligence that goes into the robotics. So nothing yet for Mars, but hopefully one day.
A question for Greg, before I jump to another question for Greg. Cesar Canizares, in Spanish, Cesar Canizares, he asks, what does space smell like?
So that's a great question. I can't honestly give you a firsthand answer for a couple of reasons. For one, because if you really smelled space, you probably wouldn't survive it, because we need to have our bodies protected with a spacesuit. But unfortunately, I did help with 9 spacewalks, but I never got to put on a suit and go outside. But what I did do is, when they came in from outside, I smelled their astronaut out, their suits, their spacesuits. And I'll tell you that the smell was, it was like an aluminum ice tray. It was metallic. And of course they were cold, you know, and there were metal parts on their spacesuits, but it was sort of like a smoky gunpowdery aluminum smell is what they smelled like when they came back from space or came back into the space station.
Interesting. I suppose smells inside trip altogether depends on what you eat. I understand you like M&Ms. Can you tell us something about M&Ms and space, Greg?
Well, first of all, we're getting a little, somebody's having a good time tonight. So yes, I tend to be maybe a more lighthearted person. I work hard, but I play hard, and I like to enjoy everything in life. I don't take any day for granted, kind of like a Martian rover. You know, every day could be its last day. So, you know, there's rovers that last for years and years past their expected life. So I won't get philosophical on you, but I do try to really savor the moment. And in space, it was important to have that social impact and communication when we're eating. So we always ate dinner together. I insisted on it. And of course, as the pilot, I'm really the butler, the maid, the janitor, the plumber. And so I also was sort of the cook when they'd come in from the spacewalks. But when we ate our meals together, I would often have for dessert M&Ms. And the M&Ms all have different colors on them. And each of the crew members, we all had our colors of our, that all our scissors and food and items had our crew colors on. I was yellow. Mark Kelly was red. Mike Fink, by the way, who was on this flight, he was blue, I think. So I'd pick out the blue M&Ms and I'd toss them to Mike Fink, and they'd go straight into his mouth. You know, sometimes he'd have to move his head a little bit. And so the M&Ms were a fun way to enjoy dessert, not get chocolate on your hands, and enjoy the moment with your crewmates.
That's great. When you said not get chocolate on your hands, I noted I noticed when there was a picture of somebody in space, the sole of the shoes were really clean. really, really, really clean. Now, one question for both of you. And Gustavo, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing your last name wrong. In Spanish, it would read Jamanca. For the US, it would probably read Jamanca. But in any case, Gustavo asks, what kind of physical activity do you recommend to prepare for future astronaut applications, considering the current restriction? Like, the gyms are closed, there's quarantine, there's restriction of running on the street, in the streets. And it would be probably different for you in the US and also in Australia. But what would you each recommend? Let's start with Sammy.
Yeah,
sure. Okay. so for me, I focus on running and swimming more than anything else. Obviously, I have done a bit of research and I found that it's better to just be active, but not, you know, you don't need to be too extreme, because in space you're going to, well, obviously Greg will know this a bit more than I will, but you do lose a bit of your fitness. So even though there is obviously global events and, you know, we've got lockdowns and stuff, run on the spot. It's sort of a weird one, but I think when I came back to Australia, I was overseas and we have to do quarantine here. So I was in a hotel room for 2 weeks and I was just like, okay, how can I liken this to astronaut training? They don't go anywhere, so I'll run on the spot. So I think there's always a bit of a creative way you can get exercise in. But yeah, for me, I focus on swimming and running.
And I'd agree. And I'd add, I'd broaden it to what you like to do that's active. For me, I ride the bicycle, and I found that riding the bike, you know, my wife and I have been locked up in this house for a year now, and we ride the bike together and we enjoy ourselves while we exercise. I do think it's important to have some anaerobic exercise, because long duration, as Sammy said, does degrade your muscles and bones. And so going in well equipped for that hardship is important. For the short duration people like myself, aerobic exercise was the key. We had a cycle ergometer on the shuttle, and we pedaled every day. And one day I pedaled all the way around the earth. I pedaled 92 minutes. That was just to say that I just did that so I could say it afterwards. But we didn't do that much aerobic exercise, but the long duration astronauts up there for 6 months or a year, they do 90 minutes of anaerobic exercise, you know, the resistive exercise to keep their muscles and bones from degrading. So very important to do what you like to exercise, because then you'll actually do it.
Thank you, Greg. Now, something along that same line, how do you exercise? What do you do for exercise once you're actually in space? Because you're confined in a locked space.
Well, so we had the cycle ergometer. It was it wasn't exactly a stationary bicycle, because it operates differently because we're in zero gravity. So we had shoes that were kind of connected to the pedals, and we really didn't have a seat per se. We're just kind of pedaling. But the resistive exercises, they have, it's called the ARED, Advanced Resistive Exercise Device or something, but it essentially allows you to lift weights in space. And that's a permanent part of the International Space Station. We didn't have anything like that on the shuttle, and we didn't really want to bother them, the long duration astronauts, to use their equipment. So we did aerobic exercise, and then I had a TheraBand, you know, to kind of just do a resistive exercise, but I didn't do a lot of it, frankly. It was mostly just riding the bike.
Great. Now, Vanessa Dominguez asked, and this question is for you, Greg, what are some cool things about the space station that nobody told you before you actually arrived?
The cupola. They told me, I just didn't really listen. My sister told me, she's an architect. She told me a window is the most important part of a building. And of course, I disregarded my older sister. But the cupola was fantastic. I remember having a video teleconference with my wife and kids for 20 minutes. We started off over Michigan, went across the Atlantic, across Europe, the Med, and across the Sierra to Madagascar. And that 20 minutes, I shared with them the beauty of our planet, and they shared with me what was going on in their lives. And it was just a spectacular personal moment for me. The cupola, very wonderful module.
Oh, absolutely wonderful. Well, when we talk about STEM, we usually leave art out, and there's another acronym now, STEAM. It actually stands for science, technology, engineering, art, and math. But listening to you, Greg, I think it'd be a wonderful place for an artist to be, because you use words actually like unbelievable pictures, and they look like a work of art. And it would be absolutely incredible to be able to unite these categories, art and STEM. Now, a question for Sammy. Sammy, you are a diving instructor. How similar or how different is it to go several atmospheres up or several atmospheres down?
Good question. So I can definitely talk about going into the ocean, because you do obviously have a lot of pressure there. So it depends on how deep you do go. So right here on Earth, we've got one atmospheric pressure, and then every 10 meters, you get another atmosphere on top of you. So as you're 30 meters down, you've got four atmospheres of pressure on you. So anything is actually, you get pretty condensed. and you do feel it, but it's not anything too extreme, but it just means things like your lung expansion and the air you breathe condenses. So the air in your tank, it will go from something like this to this, but your lungs at the same time have done the same thing. So you're still, everything is still the same. It's just the pressure is, constricting you there. As for going into space, though, that one I am yet to find out. So maybe Greg can answer that one.
So Sammy, it's funny, in space we grow taller.
There we go.
So I grew about 4 centimeters taller. But it sounds like if I dive deep at 4 atmospheres, I'll get shorter, and I don't want that to happen. I'm already kind of a short astronaut or a short person as it is.
Maybe that's my downfall, for all the diving is in the short. It's time to go to space to grow.
Yes, it's time to go to space. And Sammy, I put this up for your benefit because you laughed before we started. But when we were talking about the views from space, this photograph was taken out of the cupola window. And literally, we were so excited. Drew Feustel and I were taking these photos of Michigan. And absolutely spectacular view from space. That's my grandparents' house down there. It's in northern Michigan.
Thank you so much, Greg and Sammy. There's a question from Stephanie. Stephanie asks, did you ever need to use GIS, that stands for Geographical Information Systems, in your profession or your staff on Earth? Greg? Did you ever need to use GIS, that's Geographical Information Systems, in your profession?
Absolutely. I mean, those sorts of maps and topography are generated for pilots, for astronauts, and also for research. And so while the data are collected from multiple sources, that's one of the sources of information that allows us to understand where we are and where we're going.
Sammy, talking about data, you also somehow work with coordinating things on land that have to do with big data. Can you talk to us a little bit about the data ETL, the extract, transform, and load, the loading of the data things?
Sure thing. So a lot of the big data aspect is that obviously there's that vast amounts, but how do you gain insights, or how do you understand what's actually hidden within the data? So when you talk about either ETL or ELT, depending on which way you want to do it, that's you're taking the data from, let's say, one system or multiple systems, and you're transforming it to understand what's actually within it. As an example, I've done predictive analytics on aviation and jet engines. So understanding what might fail before it fails, and that side of things. So looking at that, you'll have vast amounts of data, but it may not all be necessary for one part that you want to run or one part that you want to understand. So the ETL and the loading then can help you understand and help you gain that insight into one of it. And then you can do the same thing for different aspects. There is a lot that goes into it. and then from there, once you've got that, you've then got to think about like time complexities and if it's where it's processing, how it's processing, and if it's required immediately or near real time and things like that as well.
Great. You also mentioned that there's a lot of things that can be helpful when you learn from space, and especially if you're able to combine it with this knowledge that you have with analyzing big data. In Ecuador, we have some major problems with illegal fishing, and there are some real worldwide problems about human trafficking. So it's interesting how you can put all these things together with your use of the space information, the mapping, the satellite, and be able to use your knowledge of big data too. Greg, one question for you. If we go to Wikipedia and we put astronaut Greg Johnson, we get Greg H. Johnson, we get Greg C. Johnson. My question to you, is it mandatory to become an astronaut to be named Greg Johnson?
Well, I will tell you that in my class of 8 pilots, we had 31 total in our class, we had 8 pilots and the balance in mission specialists. I don't like to do math in public. I guess it was 23 mission specialists. But of the 8 pilots, 2 of us were named Greg Johnson, if you can believe that. 25% of my class, we were named Greg Johnson. So we got confused quite a bit during training. We've been friends for decades. Our rental cars have been confused. It was really funny to have 2 Greg Johnsons. I'll just tell you a very short, funny story. So I was at a sports event in Cincinnati near my hometown, and I threw the first baseball pitch. That was just an honorary thing. My brother came up for the game, and he was the catcher, and I threw it, but the stadium was full of people. And when they introduced me, they introduced me as Gregory C. Johnson, Captain Gregory C. Johnson from the U.S. Navy. It was so funny, because the PR person had looked up my name on Wiki and gotten the wrong Greg Johnson. So anyway.
That's funny because you are with the Air Force and Greg C. Johnson is with the U.S. Navy. Now that brings me to 2 more questions for you. One, you're part of Astronaut Group 17, 1998. Why is it called the Penguins?
Okay, the reason it's called the Penguins is because it's not the Dodos. Because we were the Dodos and we lobbied to get rid of that one, but it essentially is a bird that will never fly. That was sort of the idea. You generally get named by your senior class. So the Sardines, the class that had 44 astronauts in it, they named us, they tried to name us the Dodos, but we countered and they named us the Penguins instead.
That's great. And one more thing, for years, a lot of people who were addressing you would call you Box. It's actually an excellent name for an astronaut. I can just imagine Marvel making a sequel of Buzz Lightyear and Box Johnson. Isn't it wonderful? But in any case, Buzz and Box.
A go back on the Penguins thing, what made it funny was the birds that would never fly were because there were 44 Sardines and 31 of us. So there's 75 astronauts who all came to the astronaut corps at one time. So it took many of us over 10 years to fly in space. So that was why birds that never fly, penguins came about. As far as Korobka is a Russian word for box that I've learned from my cosmonaut friends. So the story I like to tell, which only has a little bit of truth to it, is if a fighter pilot flew his fighter jet into a box on one of those GIS generated maps, and saw a technology that he wasn't allowed to see. He could get debriefed and get a call sign out of it, but I can't confirm or deny the existence of the box or of the lieutenant.
He could be sent back to the earth in a box.
Or he could be sent, or I could be box shaped, like tall and, you know. But really the truth is, it was about cardboard. It really was. That's how I got my call sign. My stuff was put in the box after Desert Storm, the Persian Gulf War, and it had Johnson on it. And I went home a little early and they saw the boxes for like 6 months. And when I came back, when they redeployed from Saudi Arabia, I had the call sign box and I could not shake that call sign for 35 years. So it's sort of like, if you don't like a call sign, that guarantees that you're going to have it for the rest of your life.
That's exactly it.
And so now I just embrace it. And it makes sense because Ray J, now we can tell, you know, the difference between the other Greg Johnson, Ray J and I.
Right. Ray J and Box. Sammy, what would you like to ask Greg Johnson?
Oh, I have many questions. I guess to start with, though, looking back, what advice would you give to yourself, like as you started your journey, knowing that, you know, you started as a fighter pilot, what would you say to yourself starting as you went through your astronaut training?
You mean to ensure or have a better chance of becoming an astronaut, or just in general?
Just in general, yeah.
In general, you know, I wouldn't change a whole lot. I was driven. I did, and so that causes us to make choices. And I had to choose some of the things, you know, the dad things or the husband things or the family things that I didn't get to participate in. Sometimes I did have to choose that career move, which I don't have regret, but I'm trying to make up for it, right?
Yeah.
And I probably was too focused on just myself at first. And then when I realized the more you help people around you, and it raises the level of everyone. And so, and I also think it's important to smell the roses along the way. Sometimes I just sometimes miss things in life because I was so focused on being successful. But believe it or not, I still didn't really believe that I could become an astronaut. So maybe I would be a little bit more confident. And I think you are. I think you believe you're going to become an astronaut, and that's awesome.
I'll
shut up. What other questions? I'll be more brief.
No, that was great. Thank you. I think it is, like, it's true though. Like, you have to stop and smell the roses.
You do.
I definitely agree with the helping people thing along the way.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a success role. I was going to ask you though, so what one skill has helped you immensely being an astronaut? Something you might not have thought would help you?
Being nice.
Mm-hmm.
Being social, because it's about team, being a team player. It's about working together, and everybody brings gifts, and learning to appreciate each other for their gifts and understanding people is all part of, I think, what I call being nice. It's just being a person that people want to be locked up in a tin can in space for 2 or 3 weeks at a time. I've always been, I feel like I've always been nice, but there's a benefit to it, and it's helped me along the way. Maybe being an optimist too. I'm an optimist.
I like that. That's good.
Now, Greg, what would you like to ask Sammy?
So Sammy, I'd like to understand what I'd really like to do is have a mind meld with you. And so I can more deeply understand artificial intelligence. Mm-hmm. My daughter's boyfriend is also an artificial intelligence engineer, and he fascinates me with all the things that he's studying, the predictive, the analytics, the Internet of Things, the big data is used, and you're so fluent in it. But I guess it's not like you can stick in a USB chip and then just mail it to me so that I can put it into my head.
We can try.
But But I guess what I'd say is, what fascinates you the most about artificial intelligence that you would share with a 58-year-old old dog trying to learn new tricks?
No, that's a good question, because it is something that, you know, I think it helps if people understand it as well. It's definitely not this big scary thing that I think some people make it out to be. And the simplest sort of way I liken it to is artificial intelligence is there to help aid our lives. So we do actually use a lot of it in our everyday life already. And that's one of the things that people don't realize. So like, as an example, if you have a coffee machine, that is, you know, a form and an aspect of artificial intelligence, because it's aiding you and it's doing a human task, but as that artificial intelligence side of things. So it's definitely something, there's obviously a lot of different aspects that go into it, but essentially it comes down to it is that artificial self that can aid with human interaction and with our everyday life. So as well as things like, from a basic aspect would be things like lifts is another one. But then delving into it from, like, I guess the heavy duty top end is like the computer vision. So self-driving cars and bits and pieces. So how do we get something that is artificial and then, I mean, it's all in the name, right? Have our intelligence. So how do we then tie that back to how do we help machines understand and what goes into that? And there's a lot of different things that build into it around, you know, we want to make sure that it's used for good. I'm a firm believer in that, things like that. But I definitely think that it's, if you liken it to the coffee machine sort of thing, it's that it's not a scary thing. It's here to help. And it's actually going to, I wouldn't say it's not going to replace things, it's going to help us. So we've got times for things that we want to do and things like stopping and smelling the roses.
So you don't necessarily, you're not worried about artificial intelligence like Elon Musk, because he's afraid that it's going to get out of control. We're going to lose control of it. And that's not one of your fears. That's what I'm hearing.
I definitely have that concern, but for me, it comes back to the people who build it. And I think you have to be human first. And that's one thing I liken it to, compassion and human first. And I, for one, am what I would consider ethical coder. So if I get asked to do something and I don't agree with it, I will not do it. So it's about encouraging people in that education piece that it's not tech for tech's sake, and we shouldn't just build everything because we can. There has to be some limitations to it. And especially, you know, going forward with how technology is changing, we don't want it to become the thing that takes from us. But I think there's definitely things we can do before it gets to that stage, and it should never get to that.
Final question.
Yep.
How dark is it at 4 atmospheres when you dive?
Oh, it's actually not bad at all.
It's pretty light. It's not dark.
No, it is pretty light. Yeah, so 40 or 30 meters roughly.
30 meters, okay.
Yeah,
so that would be that question meters. Too. Thanks for answering that. But I was thinking, yeah, 15 feet, but it's like 20 feet times whatever.
Yeah.
You're talking metric, I'm talking feet. 30 meters, yeah. Got it. 100 feet.
So, you know, you do see light, and it does make its way down, but you lose red, and red is the first color to go. So when you're down there and, like, you actually can't tell what color things are. So as much as you can see light, if you were to cut yourself, your blood looks black and it's like this dark green sort of color. And that's one of the things I teach, actually, to make sure that people, because you can get narcosis underwater, which is when people start to, you know, it affects their brain and coordination. So always get people to do maths underwater, which no one hates doing above water anyway. So I don't know why we try and do it underwater, but bringing like red items and things down so you can see what light does the further you go into the ocean. So
that's fascinating. It's a little bit like taking away the oxygen in an altitude chamber, because or going to Pike's Peak, you don't realize it, but you lose some of the color. It probably is something different, but I'm likening them to the same. And one final question. I'm sorry, Karina, but how long do you spend on the ascent from 4 atmospheres? How long does it take to prevent the bends?
So it would depend how long you've actually spent down there. So okay. There's a whole bunch of calculations that you go into it. You'll have a maximum bottom time that you can do at that depth.
Okay.
That's to prevent the bends. Generally, though, it might be 6 minutes.
Oh, so not that long, unless you spend a ton of time down there. Okay.
You can only realistically spend 20 minutes at that depth, with how the oxygen levels and things like that and narcosis. And then on your way up, so to decompress slowly, it's like if you shake a Coke bottle and then, you know, if you were to undo it, it would just sort of explode. Mm-hmm. This is bad, but that's what's happening to your blood. So you have to go slowly to like degas, and that's essentially what it is. So you come up slowly and you'll come up from 30 and you'll spend a minute or two at 20 meters, and that helps the gases release from your blood system, and then you'll come up, and then just as a mandatory sort of safety thing, everyone needs to stop at 5 meters for 3 minutes to off gas. And then, you should be fine.
Yeah, but we couldn't fly airplanes within 24 hours of diving, scuba diving. Yeah,
it's the same thing.
Interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, I'm sorry. I'm curious. It's on my list. Curious, it's on my list.
That's okay. I dive too, so I have all these questions. Now, Sammy, on this same line about diving, so I am assuming you've also used rebreathers, or are you talking about just your regular tank?
I'm just talking about regular tank for this one. So technical diving is where you use the rebreather. And that's like a whole other subset of diving.
Yeah, because I was going to ask you how you would compare rebreathers with something that you would use in astronaut training. Now, we have a question from Melissa to Sammy. But before that, I'd like to say hello to Valeria Moran. She is one of the youngest, if not the youngest, member of the YAQ Space Society. She's joining us from La Condamine in Quito. And she has a YouTube channel with anything that has to do with space. And she's 12 years old and she's watching that. Nice. Thank you so much, Valeria, for being with us. So now to Melissa's question. This question is for Sammy. If you had the chance to go to Mars on the SpaceX flight for 2026, would you?
Sure. Yeah, definitely. I think there's a lot of things that we need to think about between now and then, but definitely. I think for me, it comes back to that curiosity. Like, I just want to understand and I just want to see and I just want to explore. Yeah.
And this one is for Greg. This is from Max Meyer. Max asks, Greg, what were you most nervous about for your first mission?
So you have to be a little bit crazy to strap yourself to a, you know, four million pounds of thrust or whatever. Actually, it's more than that. It's about six and a half million pounds of thrust. But I think I was intimidated the most about the launch itself. I had lived through a couple of shuttle accidents. I had experienced during my career, first as an early pilot when we lost Columbia or lost Challenger, and then at the beginning of my astronaut career, we lost Columbia. And so I was intimidated about the launch, and it did not disappoint me. It was sensory overload, sound, light, vibration. Every sense of your body is affected by one of those crazy launches. So I think that probably intimidated me the most. Valeria, it looks like you're at Kennedy Space Center. Sorry.
That's okay. Greg, one question from Alexander, and this goes along to when you mentioned that there's more cultural awareness and there's more of a mix with women and men and several races. Alexander says, if I am Latin American, what kind of possibilities do I have for working for NASA?
So I'd say the best possibilities in history. We're not there yet as far as pure, gender and race equality, but we're getting better and better. we're learning to appreciate and be empathetic of our neighbors. And so I would say, you know, the space family has grown, and you know, all the countries around the world, in Latin America, South America, Central America, Africa, are going to be involved in this journey together. And it's just a matter of time when the actual countries are going to join formally into the partnerships. But you can also, you know, you can get engaged with a space agents, different space agencies around the world. There's different rules. At NASA, you have to be a U.S. citizen, but there are different rules, and so it's definitely a possibility and something that you should pursue if that's what you want to do.
Great, Greg. Now, Melissa, so that it is stated and it is left here, even recorded, says, everyone disregards their older sister. I know this because I am one. And Melissa also says, Greg, how do astronauts take care of their mental health?
Okay, so to my sister comment, I did eat crow, which is an expression in the US for, hey, I admitted that I was wrong. I went back to my sister and told her how right she was about that cupola, okay? Now, what was the second question? Oh, the mental health? Well, they do test us a lot. And so I went through many batteries. The original astronaut candidate, you know, astronaut interview, they did a big, long psychological evaluation, and they've done different tests along the way to ensure, you know, that we've minimized the impacts of not being in control of your emotions, right? And but I think in general, what's there not to be happy about? I loved every minute in space. I didn't want to come back fully. I mean, I did want to see the family. I missed everybody, but I really would have stayed there for a longer time. And my wife will kill me, probably. She hears me, I'm sure, because she's the only other occupant in this house. And she would definitely kill me if I answered the question that Sammy did about going to Mars. But I'd go in a heartbeat. Just saying.
Yeah. In fact, actually, there was a question, Greg and Sammy, would you go to Mars? Yeah. Greg, you have a company called Space Nation. How can people get involved in everything that you're doing with Space Nation?
I think if you go to the Space Nation website, you can learn about the philosophy behind the organization. But broadly, Space Nation is about helping people to appreciate space in their different ways. It's www.spacenation.org, by the way, is the website, and Stefan just put that on the chat. And it's about universal citizenship. You know, we country citizenship. We have, you know, citizenship in different breakouts of the Earth, but globally. We're global citizens. And then, as you said, Karina, we're just another satellite going around the sun. And so we're a very little small part of the universe. And it's about being a universal citizen and learning of the necessity for us to expand our frontiers, to grow, to learn together. And like Sammy suggests, to look back at the planet and appreciate it and make it a better place. And so all these things are the ideas, the mindset of being a space traveler that Space Nation brings to bear. And it could be a course, it could be an article, it could be an expedition. We do some expeditions around the planet that are a high adventure and more astronaut-like, expedition-like. And so whatever you like, whatever your cup of tea is, there's something to learn and be curious about.
Great, Greg. We have a question, Greg, from Zoe Silverstone, and her question reminded me of that part of the video where you wanted to wear sunglasses. Do astronauts have to sit or float in front of UV lights in space? Do they take vitamin D supplements?
So that's a very good question. There were astronauts who were burned by ultraviolet light before we really understood the impacts that it could have on the human body. Now that the glass that we use on the spaceships are treated to help protect from UV, but it can be very intense. And so we did have, for example, doing a rendezvous as we're flying into the sun, we had special protective glasses to protect our eyesight from the sun. But the UV piece of it is also a part of that. But I think the design of the windows helps us with that problem.
And one more question, I guess, for you, Greg, and please feel free to jump in, Sammy. Any of you really, what fuel do the rockets use to launch from Earth towards the International Space Station?
Okay, so we use all kinds of different fuels. It really depends on the rocket design. It can be hydrogen and oxygen, cryogenic liquid hydrogen and oxygen, what fueled the space shuttle main engines. Ammonium perchlorate is what we used for the solid rocket boosters. We use hypergolic hydrazine type products for different rocket or thrusting systems. So there's really an array of the different sorts of not necessarily friendly to the Earth chemicals that we use to go to space. So hopefully Sammy's not going to just work on artificial intelligence, but she might also work in the propulsion areas to find a greener way for us to get to space.
So now propulsion is something I'm interested in.
Has been added to your mission, Sammy. Yeah,
yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. Now, a question for Greg, and this comes from a five-year-old who's sitting next to Denise Salvas. She asks, does a person choose to float or not to float into the ship? How do they do it?
You have no choice but to float because you can't walk. There is no gravity pulling on your body. And it's easy to say, but it's really amazing when you're really in continuous microgravity. With me, when I first got to space right after that 8-minute ride in the shuttle, I laughed hysterically for like 15 seconds because I couldn't believe that my body was just floating like that. And all my checklists and everything were floating. It was unbelievable. It was like another world that's hard to describe. Zero gravity is amazing and I highly recommend it. Even as a retirement community, nobody's gonna break their hips or anything in space. There's no gravity pulling on your body. You can't fall down.
Yeah, Greg, that sounds awesome. In fact, one of our guest speakers was actually the owner of Zero G Launch. And we had him here and it was great. It was outstanding learning about all that. Now, one question also, Sammy, when you went to explore the Titanic, how cold was the water from 1 to 10? Or if you actually know the number?
So for this one is part of my what's next on my space journey. So I haven't been there yet, but it's happening next year. So I'll keep everyone updated for sure. But I can imagine it's going to be pretty cold.
Do you already have your, what is it, a 7 millimeter?
I'm going to need more than that because I don't have Queensland weather in 7 millimeter. So we'll see. But yeah, once I have the specs and the details on it, but remembering it's going to be 4 kilometers to the bottom, which is quite a lot of time. But mm-hmm. It won't just be me in the water. There'll be a submersible, which will be needed.
Wow.
That's thick. How thick can those suits get? 7 millimeters. That's a pretty thick suit.
I was diving in Thailand and I needed a 3 millimeter in 30 degrees. Like, I just have no hope. So I hope it's at least warm in space where I can pack a jumper.
Wow.
Yeah. This is what happens when you grow up in Queensland. It's warm all the time.
Right. The one that I had for California was actually 7 millimeters. And we used that for Catalina Island diving. That was pretty cool. Now, another question for you, Greg, from Jaime Garbo. What evidences can you mention that make more reliable the Atlas V rockets in comparison with former rockets, which some of them had accidents?
So, you know, I can't honestly tell you the can you hear me? I can't honestly tell you with any surety why the Atlas rockets have been so successful. I don't know what element is the component in their design, their secret sauce. I would say that the legacy, some of the legacy propulsion systems and you know, systems, they stand on the shoulders of giants and tried and true methods of success. But I really couldn't tell you what that secret sauce would be. It's like 100% though. It's amazing.
That's great. Well, we're about to wrap up. Sammy, your last phrase, your goodbye phrase.
Oh, my goodbye phrase. This is a tough one. I would just have fun and look up.
What about you, Greg?
I would say continue being curious, continue learning and sharing. I mean, this community is wonderful to me. It's an international audience of people that are interested together and learning. And so I say it, always keep learning.
Great.
I'm with you on that one. Yeah, that's a good one. There's always great. Something to learn. Yeah.
Yep.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Greg. Thank you, Sammy. Thank you all of you for being here. And we have to say a big, big, huge thank you to David Alexander, who was here from the CEN, the Centro Ecuatoriano Norteamericano, Kurt Ferre, if I pronounce it correctly. It actually handles everything that has to do with the connections and the electronics. Thank you, Kurt. Consuelo Hidalgo and Fernanda Aguirre are also here with the send. And we're very thankful to Hotel Oro Verde, Ingrid Rodriguez, Fernando Arrigorriaga, that's his last name. Rick Matten, who has been here. Thank you so much, Rick, for being here with us. And remember, we have a date. It's April the 8th, and we're going to be on NASA TV. And hopefully all of you can join us. If you want to become a member of the Guayaquil Space Society, you don't have to pay anything. We'd love to have you here. And it's always great to see you, even virtually, every so many weeks. Thank you so much for being here. A big hello from Guayaquil, Ecuador. Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck, Sammy, on your journey.
Thank you. Thanks for chatting with us. Thanks, everyone.
All right. Good night, everybody. Thank you.
Good night. Good night, everyone.